We'll make a start. Welcome to the 28th meeting in 2015 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. The committee was in Isla Andura earlier this week in meetings with tenant farmers and representatives of Isla Estate and others, as well as hosting a public meeting on a land reform bill in Scotland. I would like to thank those that we met for their time and the evidence provided, and I would also like to thank all those who attended our public meeting for their interest in the bill and for assisting us with our deliberations. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones as they may affect the broadcasting system. However, you may notice that some committee members consulting tablets during the meeting to do so because they are using the tablets to read their papers. I should also welcome Jamie McGregor, who's coming to the committee for a section of this business regarding MPAs. So agenda item one today is a decision on taking business in private. The first item then this morning is to decide on items 5 and 6, to take these in private. Are members in agreement that we should do so? We are agreed, so we will take items 5 and 6 in private. Agenda item two today, decision. So we're going to welcome to take evidence on the Agricultural Holdings Remedial Order 2014 on mediation and compensation processes. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. That's Richard Lochhead, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Food and Environment. Paul Cackette, Deputy Solicitor and Head of Group 2, and Trudi Sharp, Deputy Director for Agriculture, Rural Development and Land Reform. Good morning to you all. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. I would like to make a short opening statement to set out the Scottish Government's position in a number of areas relating to mediation and compensation. These areas have been covered more in detail in the correspondence so far with the committee, and most recently in my letter to you of the 17th of September. The issue we're discussing today is, of course, of importance to many tenant farmers in Scotland and indeed landlords, and it relates to changes to one category of tenancy agreements between landlords and tenants. Prior to 2003, limited liability partnerships could be dissolved with minimal notice. This potentially exposed tenants to the risk of their tenancy agreements being revoked at very short notice. The Agricultural Holdings Scotland Act 2003 sought to protect the position of those tenants and transferred their tenancies into 1991 Act tenancies, long-term heritable tenancies with security of tenure and succession rights. However, on the 24th of April 2013, 10 years later, the Supreme Court issued its judgment in the case of Salveson versus Riddle, which involved a dispute between a landowner and a tenant over the dissolution of a limited partnership. In its judgment, the court held that Section 7210 of the 2003 Act was outside legislative competence as its effect breached landlords' ECHR property rights. The court provided the Scottish Government with 12 months to put right the defect. The Agricultural Holdings Scotland Act 2003 Remedial Order 2014 is the legal remedy put in place to address the defect, and it came into force on the 3rd of April 2014. The remedial order sought to balance the respective ECHR rights of landlords and tenants and allows landlords a means of recovering vacant possession through Section 73 of the 2003 Act. To bring tenancies to an end, the landlords must serve conversion notices. The remedial order contained a cooling-off period in which these notices can be served, and this period ends on the 28th of November 2015. A few weeks' time. The cooling off period and notice provisions in Section 73 ensure that tenants served with dissolution notices are therefore afforded 4.5 years of extra tenure under the remedial order, meaning this runs until 28th of November 2018. The remedial order places such tenants in a better position than they would have been had the 2003 Act's provisions not violated the rights of the landlords. In that event, the tenancies would have ended in dissolution of the limited partnership, or shortly thereafter through the operation of Section 73. Under the remedial order, the tenant has 3 further years of tenancies under the sections 72A and 73, as I've said above. So landlords and tenants have been and are also free to agree private arrangements. And if landlords take no action by the 28th of November this year, then the tenancies converted under the 2003 Act will remain as 1991 Act tenancies. We understand around 350 notices were served on the night of the 3rd of February 2003. Now, however, only 7 cases, to our knowledge, remain unresolved. For those remaining 7 cases, we have proposed and do propose mediation to encourage and secure positive working relationships between affected landlords and tenants and find appropriate solutions to support the ongoing viability of the affected holdings. The Government initially proposed a 2-stage process for mediation, with Stage 1 focusing on sharing information and clarifying facts, and Stage 2 offering the possibility of a negotiated position or solution, if appropriate, in light of the particular circumstances of each case. In practice, I think it's fair to say, and I think the committee accept as well, the Government's proposed procedure has not materialised in the way that we did envisage. We asked any party wishing to engage in mediation to clarify whether they wish to claim against the Scottish Government and the legal basis of such a claim before entering into mediation. This was so we could assess and confirm our position, so any participation in the mediation by the Scottish Government would be on an open and understood position about liability. The offer of mediation was taken up by the tenant and landlord associated with just one farm. That tenant was one of 7 who took their claims to court against the Government, however, by raising a petition in the court session in March 2015. However, the landlord in the case only intimated a claim on the 17th of August 2015. The Scottish Government's position on compensation has always been that we could not comment on or commit to the payment of compensation in individual cases until the basis of such claims had been made known to us. This was the position during the passage of the Remedial Order and reiterated when I wrote to the committee on the 5th of December 2014. The current position is that 7 tenants have raised this multi-million pound court action against the Government seeking compensation. The action has been sustained until the 19th of October and liability has been repudiated. The Scottish Government's position on liability has been consistent from the start, and we cannot pay compensation in settlement of a claim which has no legal or factual basis. We have acknowledged that the Remedial Order may only be part of the solution, and have said that the Scottish Government is and has always been open to considering all claims presented to us. At the time of the Committee's consideration of the Order in 2014, we did not know the basis of any claim that might be brought against the Government in future. In evidence to the Committee, we confirmed that any future case would be considered on its merits in light of the particular facts and circumstances. This was clearly never intended to be a blank cheque to pay compensation regardless of liability, and nor could it have been. So our position remains that should a claim against the Scottish Government be presented and we take the view that legal liability will arise, then we will of course consider the claim in that context. However, in light of the committee's concerns and those of the tenant farmers and no doubt landlords and their agents, I give the commitment to the committee that I am determined to resolve this as quickly as possible, if at all possible, provided we can persuade the landlords and tenants to come into the mediation process. And given the next few weeks will be crucial in doing that, we will redouble our efforts to try and make that happen.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I invite members to ask questions of the Cabinet Secretary at this moment. Alec Ferguson.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for that statement, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning. I don't think it's going to serve a great purpose to rake over too much what's happened in the past. But I couldn't help notice, Cabinet Secretary, that you mentioned the importance of sharing information throughout this process. In evidence we've been given, it is quite clear that the process that the tenants involved and their representatives, and indeed this committee, thought had been agreed, effectively ground to a halt after the court cases were tabled, if that is the correct expression. Whether or not that should have had an impact on the mediation process, which you say it has, and I don't dispute that, it clearly was that information was clearly not shared with the tenants and their representatives, who have been left hanging in an information vacuum since early April until, as far as I can see, this committee raised the matter with you during the summer recess to try to kickstart the process again. Now, it seems in previous discussions that we've had, it seems to me that all the actions that have been taken since the end of March have been entirely reactive by Scottish Government and Scottish Government officials. Can you give us an absolute assurance that you and your officials will now effectively get on the front foot and become proactive in bringing this pretty sorry mess back to the table to try to reach a satisfactory conclusion?
Well, I certainly give the committee the assurance that we will redouble our efforts to try and resolve this issue. We are just as keen as anyone else to see a just outcome for those involved in the six or seven cases still on the table. Without going over old grounds, clearly there have been a couple of milestones in the process that have affected the pace of getting to a resolution. Firstly, we had to await for the basis of the claims to be presented to us prior to the mediation process starting, and that did take some time. And whilst I will certainly investigate the evidence that you've been presented as a committee in terms of the government's role in contributing towards the slow progress, I'll look at that and, you know, I'm concerned about that. Clearly that was a contributing factor. And the second factor was when we learnt that a court action had been lodged against the government, clearly for substantial levels of money. And therefore, that kind of changed the environment in which we're operating and what we could see and when we could see it, because there's a live court action against the government from the tenant farmers involved, and that happened in March. So clearly that played a role in the pace of getting this resolved. However, I do give you the commitment.
Yep. If I could just extend that a little bit, I mean, I hear what you say about the court case in March, but the point I was trying to make is that nobody told the tenants representatives that this would have an impact on the pace of the mediation process. Nobody told them. This needs to, you know, you talked about the importance of information sharing. I absolutely agree with you. But information stopped being shared once those court cases came into being. You know, this needs to move forward. It needs to be proactively done by your officials. And I think you have given us an assurance that that will be the case.
Okay, thanks. I mean, clearly we're dealing with a case here that goes back to 2003. And we put forward the remedial order in Parliament, which we felt, under the circumstances, gave the best possible outcome for the tenant farmers in particular, in terms of the four and a half years they would at least have as a minimal period to remain in their farms. However, it's against a very complex backdrop of both legislation and legality. So agents were appointed by the tenant farmers whom we have dealt with over that period of time. If that has not worked in terms of sharing of information, as I said before, that does cause me concern, and I will certainly look into that.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, Mr. Lochhead. Yeah, I'm just trying to get to the bottom of why there has been a change there. I've had evidence from tenants who have been unfortunately involved in this sorry mess that they were. There was a government official appointed mediators working with them, and then it suddenly stopped just overnight, and they could not communicate with them in any respect whatsoever. So it seems there was a change by the Scottish Government almost overnight. And when you gave evidence to us, and it's in our report, February 7th, 2014, that there was a recognition that there may be some compensation that would come forward, but even so, at that stage, you were committed to funding mediation, and you even stated that it would cost an estimated 40,000. I remember we thought that was quite low because that was for all, but and you actually said if the cost goes above 40,000, we will cover it. So, is it the cost that the mediation has actually arisen that has made you change your mind on helping people with the mediation, or has it been a reaction completely to what you knew would have happened, which was the fact that there may be some tenants actually looking for compensation from the government itself?
Okay. Well, firstly, no, it's not the cost of the mediation, and we did indicate to the committee that we made £40,000 available for the mediation process. Part of that has been used up, part of it is still available. So clearly, it's not a cost issue. In terms of compensation, no one wants to be caught up in messy court actions. We do not want tenant farmers to find themselves in that position. Clearly, the government does not want to end up being in the courts in relation to an action from tenant farmers due to something happening back in 2003, which we're doing our best to fix in a just way. And we have to remember the Supreme Court's findings in 2014 found that the landlords were the injured party. And therefore, there's not just the tenant farmers to consider in terms of compensation, there's the landlords as well. And therefore, in terms of the mediation process, which would be both tenant farmers and landlords, as well as the government being involved in that, we are unable to put ourselves in a legal position where we get in with an open checkbook into that environment. So that clearly has been a sticking point. How we could get ourselves into a position where the mediation process can work without us being in a position where we get in with an open checkbook with the public purse picking up any compensation costs with both tenant farmers and landlords who were found as the injured party by the Supreme Court seeking compensation. And the purpose by which I said that the government was willing to keep compensation on the table was simply that if there was a legal liability for the government, rather than fight it through the courts with the tenant farmers, it had been everyone's interest that we reached a settlement through the mediation process. And that's why I was willing, and still remain in that position, that compensation would not be taken off the table, because clearly it would be a better alternative in some circumstances than fighting a messy action through the courts.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, I appreciate that answer, but we're talking about two different things. The mediation, that's between the tenant and the landlord, and we must ensure that continues in some respects. I appreciate that maybe the Scottish Government have now had second thoughts and are concerned about mediating in case that leaves them open to compensation, but therefore what we really need, and I would have hoped that you'd been able to come to this table today with something, was the solution of continuing the mediation, whether you're bringing in independent mediators in some respects, rather than basically stopping help with mediation overnight, which seems to have happened several months ago.
Well, even in the last few days, we now find ourselves in a better position in terms of mediation, hopefully be able to move forward in that we've had an intimation from the tenant farmers that they're willing to take part in the mediation process. So, you know, I will be very keen for that to happen, and to happen as soon as possible.
Okay, as far as I get from my letters from tenant farmers, is they've always been very keen to participate with the mediation. Thanks. Yeah.
Okay, Mike Russell.
Cabinet Secretary, can I quote from the judgment itself in the Supreme Court, which recognised, and I quote, that any adverse effect on the rights of tenants resulting from the decision will need to be resolved via, and these are the words, a fair and constructive process agreed by the Parliament and guided by Scottish ministers. And this committee, when it was reporting on the remedial order, made two points that are very germane to that. It said that the government must accept liability for anyone who is financially and or personally disadvantaged by the remedy put in place and for any stress suffered by those involved. And it went on to say that it was important that the enactment of the proposed draft order did not lead to a drawn-out compensation process and should be concluded as timiously as possible. Now, I think the situation we're in now is that all three of those are in some danger of not being achieved, all three of those objectives. So I think certainly what I would be looking for, and I think the tenants are looking for, and I imagine the committee is looking for, is a commitment, and I think, to be fair, you have made that commitment earlier on, I just want to be explicit about it, a commitment that you are still committed to the fair and constructive process, that you do accept, by negotiation, of course, that there is liability for those who are financially or personally disadvantaged, and that finally, you are committed to doing something about the process, because it seems to me that the process has gone badly wrong. Now, whatever the reason for that is, and that's not what we're here to talk about, it does mean that tenants now are unsure about the future, are unsure about what lies ahead, and though that some may have the prospect of another 3 years, they're not sure of that process. So they need to have information The legal process needs to be speeded up, and there needs to be a commitment in public that this is going to be resolved within the parameters that were set by the Supreme Court and accepted by this parliamentary committee and by the Parliament when the report was given. Because these were not just observations. The report was accepted by the Parliament, the remedial order was accepted by the Parliament, the judgment was accepted by the government, so these are commitments that need to be honoured.
And I do want to give the committee the commitment that I will do my utmost to resolve this in an equitable and fair manner and also review the process that will help achieve that. Clearly, the chain of events that's got us to where we are, I'm not saying the government is completely blameless here at all, and if there's issues with the process or communication, I will investigate those concerns. But clearly there have been a sequence of events out with our control that have also influenced the pace of progress. The government's approach has always been kind of twofold. Firstly, there was the remedial order itself, where we went to great lengths to ensure that we were not in a situation where tenant farmers were going to have to leave their farms quickly. And clearly, the remedial order has allowed 4.5 years of extra tenure that may have otherwise been the case, including an 18-month cooling-off period. And other than one well-documented case, you know, my understanding is no notices to quit have been served, and therefore we still have a few weeks left up until the conversion deadline that the landlords have the opportunity to take advantage of. So the second stage of the process, which I was going to mention, is finding a way of resolving this so we don't have a situation where farmers feel themselves in a very vulnerable situation and face leaving their farms if that can at all be helped.
They do presently feel in that position, as you know, so I think that that remedy within a very short timescale is what is required, and I'm sure the committee will want to know, to hear back from you, you know, over the next few weeks that timescale has been observed.
And the final comment I just really want to make in response to Michael Russell is that I will do that, but clearly there are other parties in this process. There's the landlords, who under the Supreme Court judgment are the injured parties. There's the tenant farmers and the government. So clearly, hopefully we can all play a constructive role in getting us to where we want to get to.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And that clarification, I think, will be helpful to everybody because the confusion that has proceeded has not been in anyone's interest, landlords or tenants. I would like to highlight the case of one constituent without going into any detail about it, simply because there is a notice to quit, which is by the 28th of November of this year. And I think it's, yes.
Full about matters that may be sub judice.
Right, thank you, Convener, for that reminder. I think it would be helpful in terms of the timescale for that tenant if it was possible, and I do appreciate it's a complex case, which is not appropriate to discuss here, but it was possible to have a commitment to look at a way in which that might be, if not resolved satisfactorily, which may not be possible, at least looked into by the Scottish Government in a very urgent manner to see whether there's anything that can be done to support the family who do face an eviction order.
I will look at the details of the case and whether there's any prospect of a role for the government. I do know already that the offer of mediation in that particular case, I understand, has been offered. And the circumstances around the case, whilst not going into detail for obvious reasons, do not directly relate to the remedial order we're discussing today, but, you know, it's a sensitive case. Therefore, I will look at it.
Right, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Are there any other questions for the Cabinet Secretary just now? Yes, Graham Day.
Thank you. Can we just a point of clarity? I think Mike Russell talked, or Alec Ferguson talked earlier about proactivity in this process. And you made the point a few seconds ago about needing the landlords to engage in this as well for the mediation process. Will government officials proactively approach the landlords concerned to try and encourage them to engage in this, rather than just simply sit back and see if they're prepared to do it?
Yes, we will. And clearly, a lot of the communication at the moment has been through legal agents mm-hmm. on behalf of all the various parties, but I will, in light of today's comments in the committee, we'll redouble our efforts to make sure the communication is
right.
good.
Okay.
Jim Hume.
Thanks very much, convener. I just wonder if I've heard the mention of a commitment to get the mediation going again. I wonder if we could forecast a timetable for that process to actually occur. Would that be a possibility at this stage?
Well, clearly the email I think I was referring to earlier on only arrived yesterday. In the last 48 hours, and we'll respond to that email and, you know, try and push things as forward as quickly as possible. In terms of the overall timescale, I did indicate earlier on, I think the next few weeks are quite crucial. So the sooner we get that going, the better.
Okay, right, okay. Thanks.
Okay, Sarah Boyer.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just a quick question to ask where the policy lies now and whether this is something you will address in the current land reform bill that we're addressing in Parliament as to what the government's intention is in terms of this policy issue, which failed in 2003, and then you've had the remedial order. What's next in terms of the policy development?
Well, there's a couple of issues that arise out of that question. Firstly is the sensitivity we have to have in terms of ECHR and property rights, which clearly the Supreme Court judgment was based upon, and which gives us all pause for think in terms of future legislation, because I do not want the forthcoming legislation and land reform, which contains provisions on agricultural holdings, to end us up allow us to be end up in the position we're in just now due to the 2003 Act. We don't want to be in the same position in a few years' time, so I have to be conscious of that in terms of taking forward the policy. The second issue is that over limited partnerships, where more work will have to be done in relation to limited partnerships. I think that's something the committee took an interest in. So that is a very complicated issue, because the focus of the agricultural holdings provisions within the Land Reform Bill focus on other dimensions of agricultural holdings, and not specifically limited partnerships.
Thank you, Convener.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Point of clarification, please. Cabinet Secretary, the petition for judicial review that was lodged in March is, as I understand it, one of the reasons for the lack of things moving forward, the failure for things to move forward. Will that now in any way, will the fact that that still exists now in any way impede the process that we have been talking about today in relation to mediation and compensation? Because I would like clarity on that. I'm not quite sure what's changed.
My understanding, it does, insofar as we have to be careful as to what extent compensation can be discussed as part of the mediation process, because any admission of liability during the mediation process will impact on the court action. So I guess a layman's view of that would be, should we admit any kind of liability during the mediation process and there's a multi-million pound court action in the background, clearly that would influence the government's defence within the court action.
All right, thank you.
Any further questions? If there are none, I would just like to thank members for this and the Cabinet Secretary and his team. Some clarification of the communication issues between the parties has been explored, and the work of RACI, this committee, has helped to bring hopefully some clarity about an effective and timious remedy to this matter, which we all find very aggrieved about, and indeed in particular for the parties concerned, but also for the process of government that we're hoping this committee has helped to make clearer. Thank you very much. That will bring an end to this particular item, and we will change panels for the next item in a minute or two. Thank you. Welcome back to the meeting, everyone. Third item of business on our agenda today is to take evidence on marine protected areas. And we've been joined by representatives of the fishing sector. And I think it would be useful if, from the left, you introduce yourselves and say who you are.
Duncan McInnes, I'm Secretary of Western Isles Fishermen's Association.
Don't touch the microphones, they're dealt with.
I'm Willie John McLean. I'm here on behalf of the Mallaig North West Fishermen's Association.
Kenny McNab, Chairman of the Clyde Fishermen's Association.
Alasdair Hughson, Chairman of the Scottish Scallop Divers Association.
Alistair Sinclair, National Coordinator, Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation.
Steve Bastiman, Conservation Officer for the Scottish Sea Angling Conservation Network.
David Fraser, Scallop Fisherman.
Well, thank you very much for being here, and good morning to you all, gentlemen. We wish to explore some issues related to the creation of MPAs, and we're interested in looking at the, first of all, the effectiveness of the consultation process, which I think I'll ask the first question about, because subsequent to the earlier consultations by the Marine Scotland, it's been alleged that they weren't reflective of the reality of the economic impacts and so on. So I'd like to ask if anyone, and you don't all have to answer, but you indicate to me, we'll bring you in, about the consultation process and your understanding of its provenance and its range. Duncan McInnes.
Firstly, you know, I'd have to say that Marine Scotland and the fishing industry had considerable dialogue over a number of years, you know, in the formation of the locations of marine protected areas and Marine Scotland also had extensive consultation in the, in the wider communities, and those were well attended throughout Scotland, and it was clear that from a fishing industry point of view, you know, that there was a balance to be struck between protecting the marine environment and protecting the economic importance of the fishing industry, and a clear balance had to be struck in the way forward. And Marine Scotland then went out to consultation, and during the consultation process, they gave their own preferred options, which very much mirrored the way forward that the fishing industry had agreed at consultations throughout Scotland. And the preferred option was a clear balance that sacrificed some fishing areas, but also made sure that it was fully compliant with the required EU regulations for protecting the features for which the sites were being designated. However, when the response to the consultation did come back, it was the words used by the Cabinet Secretary at the time was that it was ambitious. Now, from a fishing industry point of view, we in the Western Isles and in many other coastal communities of west coast of Scotland are all conservationists because we want to protect the marine environment. And from our point of view, the approach then that was proposed by Scottish Government was, in our views, draconian, which would result in severe loss of jobs in many of the coastal communities, both at land and at sea. And from our point of view, and other witnesses can speak up for their own areas, we saw that the economic impact that was being circulated in the response that the government had to the consultation paper was grossly underestimated. We see that, you know, the fishing industry has a shared kind of environment between mobile and static gear operations, and the main added employment opportunities are created in scallop processing and nephrops or prawn processing in those areas. And we saw, for example, one area off Barra, East Bingley, where the measures that are currently being proposed for that area is that there'll be a total ban on static gear, that's fishing with pots, in that area. There are two vessels there that gross about up to quarter of a million pounds, whereas the economic impact that came from Scottish Government was 19,000. Now, there's clearly something seriously wrong between 19,000 and quarter of a million. And if you look at the two vessels that were involved in that, they employ 10 local vessels, three of them in Barra, and the skipper there has said, there is no question whatsoever, I'll have to sell my vessel. The other one is the newest Vivier boat in the Western Isles, employing seven local people. He says he's questioning the viability of that vessel. In addition to that, the proposal was to put a prohibition on set nets. That's set nets that are set on the seabed in all those sites. And in the Western Isles, we've been, and other areas of Scotland from Tyree and those islands, they've been fishing since 1978 with set nets for crayfish. Clearly, that's a seasonal basis. That was discussed at public meetings, set nets and a zoning approach whereby there'd be no set nets in the shallower water where the risk was greater of interaction with birds and the like. So a zoning approach and a seasonal approach was suggested. Now, in one instance where the vessel goes to St Kilda, crayfish is the most valuable species, shellfish species in Scotland, and that represents 40% of the value of that boat that goes to St Kilda. If the vessel has a 40% reduction in the catch, they won't go to St Kilda, and that vessel will put additional effort onto already inshore stocks. Similarly, in West Ross, where the...
We can't go through every MPA at the moment.
Yeah, that's fine. What I'm saying is, you know, from a fishing industry point of view, we are conservation-minded. In the Western Isles, we've been taking forward a very conservative approach and leading on conservation with a number of initiatives that have been taken forward by Scottish Government. And we think that there is a way forward that can be done to accommodate the interests of the fishing industry and protect the features for which the sites are designated.
We're intended to try and get to the bottom of that just now. At the moment, I don't know whether it needs all of you to answer this particular question, but the effectiveness of the consultation process, it's been suggested, agreed to one set of understandings, and then when it was presented in the form of the MPAs, that you saw another. Is that what you agree with my reasoning here? Willie, John, McLean, you indicated.
Yes, I would just like to say a bit about the process for the Small Isles MPA, because I attend a lot of meetings. We sat down with SNH and Marine Scotland. We went through things. They pointed out the features that had to be protected. The initial meeting, we weren't very happy. We went back and they had another meeting. It was well attended by fishermen, and they showed the features again, and it was agreed that to protect these features and to put a buffer zone around these features, and there was additional areas put forward by the fishermen that they could add on to this MPAs. And then we thought that the process was, we left that meeting saying, yes, we can work with these people. It's good we've all come to an agreement. And then somewhere down the line, we got informed, no, I'm sorry, we've overlooked something. And then the whole 800 and odd kilometres of sea habitat was back on, including the bits that we had put forward. We've never seen any video evidence of any of these features.
I've asked at the meetings that I've been to, and there's been no fan mussels and other mussels and sea habitat. We've never seen anything, and we're a bit concerned because there's nothing to stop them in the future coming back and closing off more of the area and saying that the fishing is affecting it. We haven't seen anything. We've continually asked for video footage. There's been ROV cameras put down since 2009 in these areas, and they've checked all the features every year, year on year. They've never come back and shown us videos that because of fishing, the features are in decline. We've seen nothing, so I think it's very unfair to force this MP on people that haven't seen it. I mean, the fishermen, we have a vested interest in the area, and it's in our interest that we look after it. And we've fished alongside these for 50 years. And
thank you. We'll be hearing more from you. Kenny McNam.
Yes, I would like to make one thing quite clear. There's been talk in the press that the mobile sector of the fishing industry don't want MPAs. Completely the opposite. We agreed with the concept of MPAs right at the very beginning, and that's why we took part in the whole process, the consultation process. And we thought it was gone very well. We sat down and I personally spent countless hours, days, in meetings with Marine Scotland and other people on these MPAs, and so did many fishermen, took time off their work and lost days fishing to do that. And we thought we had got somewhere. We thought we had reached a position and an agreement with SNH, who are the scientific body that advises the Scottish Government, were quite happy with the way things were going. And for the Minister to announce his ambition completely floored us. After spending 3.5 years in all these consultations, we all felt really let down.
Which areas are you talking about?
I'm talking about South Arran MPA and the one from Lough Sunert right down to the Jura Sound.
Okay, thank you. Ali, who is Hughson?
Our association was only formed relatively recently. We didn't have a seat at the table through most of the MPA, certainly the initial negotiations about the MPAs, and we only really became involved at the beginning of this year at the meeting in Inverness. We don't have the same issues with the MPAs that some of the other fishing groups do, so we have no complaints with the process.
Alasdair Sinclair.
We were never engaged with Marine Scotland and the MPA process from the beginning. Indeed, we only took part in the last two meetings whenever it was a done deal. And I have to accept what Kenny says there, that what these guys had signed up to had actually been changed. In other words, Richard Lochhead had moved the goalposts somewhat. He's done the same in Lochfine as well.
Why were you not involved at the beginning?
I think primarily because the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation wasn't in existence at the beginning of the due process.
All right. Okay, so that's understandable. Yeah. Steve Basterman?
Yeah, we've been involved right from the very start. It makes tremendous demands on an organisation which is staffed purely by volunteers. So I have a lot of sympathy for fishermen who have taken time off from the boats and everything like that, because we've had to do exactly the same. In general, we've restricted ourselves on the MPA work to only looking at areas within the nearshore environment rather than way out to sea, because that's sea anglers are in the nearshore environment. In general, the process we found was fine. You know, it had its ups and downs, but it seemed to go quite well, it was productive, it was reasonably transparent, until it came to Loose Bay. We were initially shown a proposal which had Loose Bay with, if you like, a hole in the middle, which we call the polo model. So the mobile sector would work in the middle and the surroundings, they wouldn't. And that was perfectly acceptable. That was something we could support, because the
periphery of Lewis Bay is where sea anglers work. There are reefs there and hard rock. But then in November of last year, that model was changed. It was the polo model at a meeting I attended on the 16th, on the 6th of November, and it changed on the 7th of November without any discussion, as far as I'm aware, certainly with ourselves and as far as I'm aware, with no other conservation or fishing groups. I don't even know if the commercial sector were involved. That was taken down to a meeting in Loose Bay, and there was another new proposal offered then, which was the preferred option, which was referred to earlier. That one wasn't found acceptable by the commercial sector there, so a new shape was formed. It seems to be a moving target, and there seems to be no reason. We've had no communication as to why these changes, you know, no real explanation as to why these changes have taken place. It just seems to be that, you know, there's stuff going on in the background, which, you know, I don't know to what extent the commercial sector are involved, other conservation NGOs, but it's all of a sudden it ceased to be transparent when it was down in Loose Bay.
Thank you. David Fraser.
Every one of these MPAs will affect me, and we did take time off and sit down with Mr. Lochhead and make suggestions which would have allowed everyone to go ahead and make a living. All the suggestions we've made have just basically been ignored. If this goes ahead, over 30% of my own boat's turnover will disappear, just like that.
Okay. Situation is that we've got to try and, you know, structure this so that we can get to the bottom of the matters. I said the effectiveness of the consultation process, which we've started off on, may lead to people asking questions about that. We will be moving on to socioeconomic factors and on to compensation issues and so on, which might begin to answer some of these matters a little later on, with particular effect on specific MPAs. I'm going to bring in Mike Russell, first of all.
Thank you. I just want to press the issue of the process of consultation a little bit more clearly, because I'm not entirely sure what happened. Can any of you explain what happened between the process in which you were discussing things with Marine Scotland, those who were involved in it, and felt that you were making progress in achieving an understanding, and the final proposals? How long was that period? What happened in that period? And what do you think took place? Because there's a big difference between the understanding from some charities, particularly conservation charities, about the process and the way you've described it. And I just want to get your perception of what happened.
Yep.
Kenny.
When we had finished, the consultation had finished, there was the three options. And we thought that the option that SNH had chosen and that the commercial sector were happy with that's what we were going to get. We weren't informed by Marine Scotland or by the Cabinet Secretary that anything different would be done. We could have made representation. We could have made more representation. That we weren't informed of.
Why did you think you were going to get them? What led you to assume that?
Well, no, nobody told us otherwise.
I would imagine, you see, when you go out for a consultation process and you make comments on the preferred options, that those have been considered by all stakeholders, and you would think that the Scottish Government would be minded to go with the preferred options that they're putting out at consultation. Now, there has been no reason given why those preferred options that clearly met all the regulations requirement of protecting the marine features, or they wouldn't have been a preferred option in the first place. And there has been certainly nothing has come across, as far as I'm aware, to industry to say our preferred option has now gone to option three or you see the option, the preferred option was the one that had least economic impact on the future of commercial fisheries and give protection to the features as well.
In your experience of negotiating with Marine Scotland, is this a unique experience, or have you had previous difficulty in getting agreement, or have you had agreement and then that's changed? I think we need to know the context of this.
I would say I've been involved in fishing for 40 years myself. I've been ashore for 25 years, and I can say that this is the worst situation I've seen that has come through from a consultation process in all my time in negotiating with Marine Scotland since the formation of the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Office prior to that. And looking back, you know, at 1984, which was one of the acts that we're talking about, you know, where various things will be managed and enforced, you know, within marine protected areas. I'll give you an example of when the previous Scottish Office didn't introduce something in the Western Isles that the fishing industry didn't agree with, and that was but a total prohibition on mobile gear in Broad Bay. I've got photographs here that were given to me by Marine Scotland scientists, and all that's there now is starfish. At the same time, the fishing industry in the Western Isles agreed with the Scottish Office at the time that there'd be a seasonal closure approach to the Sound of Barra. Similar kind of landings were coming from both areas in 84. Nothing but starfish in Broad Bay now, and 250,000 comes from Sound of Barra now. And that's sensible way forward. On seasonal closures, you can reduce the impact in marine protected areas with having a zonal arrangement on depth. You can remove or prohibit an activity in it. And that's very much in line with the interpretation of how management of those sites should be.
Willie John McLean.
When we went through the process, the fishermen took in their own charts. I mean, they've got vast experience. They've fished in that area for 50 years. They all took in their own charts, and the boats over 15 metres are monitored by Marine Scotland. So Marine Scotland had all this information, and all this was overlaid onto a chart of the proposed marine park. And you can see quite clearly that the areas that were up for protection, the boats did not fish. And then, because of that, it was agreed. There was a bit of give and take with everyone, and this was put forward, and then it came back that it wasn't to be. We've since been asked to submit information, our VMS data, and earnings and everything. And it's quite difficult getting it from Marine Scotland. But in the initial meetings, Marine Scotland had all this data available and they produced it. But it seemed to be very difficult to get when we had a meeting with Mr. Lochhead, and he proposed that if we could put through facts and figures, then they would look at it. Now, when we approached Marine Scotland, it took weeks and weeks and weeks to get this information. I don't know. When I went up and inquired about my own VMS data, I was told that it would be a long, drawn-out process to get this information. And I stated that I had put down dates, years. I'd gone back in my diary, in my fishing diaries, and I had put down each year, each month, with dates and times that I fished in that area. Now, I thought that would have been an easy enough information to retrieve off the computer, but I was told at the time no, it would be awkward for them to retrieve it.
And
but
that data would have proved what?
Well, it would have proved where we fished, and also the economic side of things, where it stated that it was only about 1%. In effect, we fished 20 to 25% in that area. And
so I think, can I just be clear, in terms of the difficulties with Marine Scotland that you're explaining to us, there's a difficulty with the consultation.
Yes.
And there's also been the difficulty in the information that they have brought forward to justify the socio-economic arguments?
Well, we were given a timescale with the extended period.
Yeah.
And because of the timescale, everyone was rushing to get new information or the information out, and it was slow in coming out.
Because those socio-economic arguments will reflect upon a question we'll deal with later,
yes,
which is compensation, and it's quite crucial which of those figures is correct.
Well, you can clearly see from the figures there's paperwork put in to validate what's been said.
I mean, David has indicated a third of your income, you say. Have you
only
produced
one on one vessel? The other one's actually nearer 50%.
And have you produced that data for?
Yes, I have it. I write down every fishing operation. I have every fishing operation for the last 20 odd years in diaries. It drives my wife mad. But it's also recorded in the VMS data because they're both over 15 metres now. Mm. My boats haven't always been over 15 metres, but you would have to trust me when I say this has been my pattern for most of my working life.
And
all these places.
And the data from Marine Scotland in terms of what they say would be lost is not the same as yours?
Not initially. I think they maybe did it from a previous year. And Michael McLeod intimated that he can see that I'm definitely telling the truth for 2014, but before that my boats didn't have VMS, so there's no way of proving it. But it's easy to prove that in 2014, okay. 30 and 50%, it's quite straightforward.
Steve Basterman and then Kenny McNab.
Just a reflection on the process. It began as a consultative process, series of workshops, meetings, representatives from a variety of bodies, all giving their thoughts. But then the model seemed to get broken. Once it went out for consultation, it ended up as being a series of individual meetings. Proposals were put forward on least economic impact to the fishing industry, as we've been told. There was no actual assessment of the impact on the sea angling industry. It became very unbalanced. Now, what that creates to is a feeling by a lot of people that there's backdoor deals being done, that, you know, favouritism and all this sort of stuff. I'm not saying that there was, but that is the feeling that's created. And then you lose a lot of support for the process. You lose a lot of support for working with the Scottish Government in trying to get these things addressed. It goes off on its own way, and then it comes back and there's the answer, and there's a whole lot of stuff missing in between. How did you get to the answer?
To finish off this series of questions, Kenny McNab.
Could I just say that we're going on about the information that Marine Scotland produced, the percentages that they produced to justify the MPAs. It's since been proved that that's all, a lot of that is flawed. I mean, it's become quite obvious since the Minister announced the MPA proposals that a lot of that information is flawed. The VMS data, the biggest part of the fleet, the mobile sector that works in these marine protected areas, are below 15 metres. So Marine Scotland have got no information on them, no VMS data. So where did it come from? Did they just pluck it out there? They were working with landing details. And when we started questioning them on some of that information, we couldn't get straight answers. The other one was, and one of the most important ones, is all of these areas, almost all, and I think Willie John would back me here, almost all of these MPAs provide shelter for boats when they're fishing. The South Arran MPA is really important to the boats in the Clyde. If you've got westerly wind, you can fish on one side. Easterly wind, you can fish on the other side. The size of the vessels, a lot of these vessels are under 15 metres. They're not capable of going out in bad weather. So what we have developed a safety issue, and every one of these MPAs There's now a safety issue with the mobile fleet. And when questioned on that, Marine Scotland, when we met the Minister on the 6th of July, Marine Scotland were present, I asked that particular question, if safety or the weather was taken into consideration when the study was done in the MPAs on the economics. The answer I got was no, it wasn't considered.
We're going to move on, I think, at the moment to Dave Thompson and then Claudia Beamish.
Are you still on the consultation, convener?
Yes, you want to? I think we've heard the...
I'm still on the consultation, please.
All right, consultation.
Unless you... No, on you. Right, thank you very much, convener. Could I just highlight a different perspective that hasn't been heard today because of the representation that's here? And I would value any comment on it, and that is from Environment Link, specifically in relation to the consultation, and I quote, "We have made our views clear via the consultation and still maintain that the scientific evidence justifies greater restrictions in some sites. For example, we contend that the prohibition on mobile demersal gear throughout the South Arran MPA would be the most appropriate form of management. The measures therefore contain compromises, and we acknowledge a progressive balance has been struck." Now, I'm only asking for comment on that because I think it's very important that we understand that there are a whole range of organisations who have put in evidence to this consultation, and maybe on the other side of the perspective, there are other views. And is this not a compromise? I ask that question.
Yep.
The South Arran MPA?
Well, I'm asking the question generally.
In general?
Yes, that was an example. I really want a general answer to the question about whether there are others who have put in perspectives based on the science as they see it, and we haven't yet got to the socioeconomic discussion, which the convener will lead off after this, but I'm asking about the consultation process.
We thought we had compromise, but it didn't turn out that way.
From your perspective?
Yes.
But from other people's perspective, they can see it having, you know, from the conservation perspective, others see it as not going far enough and it's a compromise as it stands at the moment. So that's the question I'm asking. Is there any comment on that from anyone else on the panel?
Alasdair Sinclair.
There are many within the creel sector that find that the MPA process just hasn't gone far enough. There's an appetite to maybe reinstate the 3-mile limit in the West Coast, which I know is a very hot and difficult subject, but there is an appetite within the creel fishermen because the creel fishermen historically are now being pushed either up the beach because of the activity of mobile sector operators, or they're being pushed further out, and whenever you start moving up the beach, it becomes economically unviable because you're not liable to produce a worthwhile catch and earn a living. And if you're forced further out to sea, you're then liable to the vagaries of gear conflict, where you're suffering economic loss through the loss of gear, and it's gear that you can't insure. You know, it is an economic loss. So there is an appetite within many on the West Coast. And I have to stress that that is a West Coast creel fisherman's approach to what's going on. And the West Coast creel fishermen do have the appetite for a 3-mile limit to be reinstated, whilst on the East Coast it's a completely different animal. And the MPA process is dedicated to the West Coast. What the guys in the islands want to do, the Outer Hebrides, the Western Isles, Duncan's guys, Stuart Crichton's guys and the Orkneys and the Shetland guys, what they want to do, I think they're looking towards autonomy to look after their own waters, and I think we should welcome that notion.
Yeah, okay. We've heard two sides to this already. We've heard quite a lot of the sides to this already at this particular point. We do want to try and get to just one or two of the things out of the way. I'm sure it will crop up once again when we're talking about the socioeconomics. But the safety issue was raised there, and I understand that, you know, you're talking about the South Arran one, okay? I just want to deal with this, because I don't think it's a massive one that we could probably hear your point of view. We've heard yours, but I think Willie John McLean may have an issue about the safety issues around the small aisles.
Yes, and up at the Wester Ross one as well. I mean, there's four boats work out of Ullapool, and they're trawling, and they're single-handed boats. There's only one person working these boats. And in the winter time, these boats depend on the area. The areas that the fish are made up are three or four different areas. And to access these areas, there's small areas that they can tow through. Now, these areas are closed off or will be closed off. And in the winter time, these small boats, when the weather is poor, depend on towing through these gaps in banks and that to get into sheltered areas to hold their nets. And the four that I have spoken to, that I've spoken to from Ullapool, have said that if this goes ahead, they will be finished because they can't fish in the winter time because the weather is that bad. And they depend on towing through these narrow areas to get into sheltered round corners to get out of the wind so they can haul their nets. They can tow out and they can go out into poorer weather, but it's really dangerous for them when they come to haul their nets. So they're really depending on this areas to get back in, to get into sheltered waters. And it's the same with our own. It's the same with our own in the small isles. I mean, these islands, the position of the islands, in the winter time, a lot of boats, the local boats, fish around these islands because it's the only place we can fish. If that is closed off and we don't get access to that, then we will not be able to fish. I mean, we couldn't fish for the first 4 months this year because of weather, because the weather was really that severe. But normally we can get out and fish in these areas. You're forcing boats. I mean, this is not huge industrial trawlers. This is not big 60, 70, 80-foot steel boats. I think you have some pictures of the boats that were sent in. I mean, they're not modern boats. They range from 30 years to 50, 56 years, in fact, old boats. And they were built to fish inshore inside the Minch. We don't fish day and night. We fish the daylight hours. So in the winter time, we're fishing 9 o'clock till 5 o'clock at best. But we really depend on these. I mean, if these boats were to go out and something was to go wrong, it would just be a disaster. I mean, we really do depend on these areas. The whole community depends on these boats getting out to fish in these areas. It's as simple as that. If we lose it, there is boats going to leave the industry.
We're talking about the safety issues. Was it a sub-question about safety issues that you had, Alec Ferguson?
Yes, convener. Right. Because I represent Southwest Galloway, and there are commercial fishing interests out of the Solway, as I'm sure you're all aware, and it is a largely nomadic fleet. And one of the issues that's been raised with me very strongly, on top of the perceived failings of the consultation process, is this issue of safety. And it's brought about by the potential displacement that is likely to come about if these MPAs are put in place as they are just now. And while I recognise that some of these are larger boats and more sort of commercially orientated, if you like, I would seek your opinion on whether there is actually a safety issue for these boats as well, given the nomadic nature of their operations and the displacement that will come about as a result of
That's
these restrictions.
That's part of the socio-economic bit and the displacement issues that we're just about to come on to. But if there's a safety factor alone for the boats, which Alec Ferguson's talking about, then we might take these things in order so that we can get some structure to this.
It is related, sorry.
Well, it is related. They're all related. So any other safety issues? Yes, David.
A huge issue with safety. If the Sound of Mull is closed, at the moment the ferries are cancelled when the weather's that bad, we can still work in the Sound of Mull. If that's taken away, we can't go anywhere.
Yep. Graham Day on this subject.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Thank you for letting me in. Just to be clear, you're commenting on there will be a safety issue. To what extent have you each articulated the safety issues that you're concerned about, and what was the reaction to that articulation? I mean to Marine Scotland. Mr McNab's already outlined his position, but the rest of you.
blue in the face. It's always been the most important thing in the boats is a safety issue. If we don't have sheltered water to work on in the storms, we can't work safely.
I accept that point, but what I'm asking specifically is, in the discussions you've had, the face-to-face discussions, whether with the Cabinet Secretary or Marine Scotland, have you specifically articulated these concerns and during the MPA consideration process, and what was the reaction?
What we were told that we could do was move elsewhere. That was basically what we were told. There's other areas we can fish, and unfortunately, a lot of the areas that we are that we classed as sheltered are getting eroded because of there's fish farms. I mean, they are moving out of lochs and into sheltered areas, and unfortunately, it's the areas we fish because they need the same mud for their anchors to hold. So we're losing a large part of ground to the fish farms as well, and it just happens to be areas that we fish in the winter time. So our safe areas are getting condensed into a smaller and smaller and smaller area.
Okay.
I think you'll be able to come in on this one, Duncan.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just on this point, before we move on to the socio-economic impact and so on, my understanding is that when the detailed work was done with Mallaig and North West in relation to the Small Isles MPA, there was a lot of very detailed consideration of the tows that Willie was talking about and the implications for safety, and at different weather conditions, you know, if it was a westerly or an easterly or whatever, they could, because of all the islands in that area, they can move around and still be safe. But am I right in thinking that the detailed work and the very detailed charts that were produced in relation to, you know, where the boats would work, that in the final version that came out, it was basically a blanket ban over big areas with no consideration of that kind of detail, and that's what has concerned folk.
3 square kilometres that's closed, that will be closed, potentially closed.
Yeah, well, what I was going to say was certainly that is the Marine Scotland response. You can go and fish somewhere else, which, you know, we're looking at small inshore vessels that have, they're not nomadic, they've localised, the local communities depend on them being fishing in those areas. And, you know, it may be all right for someone sitting at a desk in Marine Scotland to say you can shift somewhere else, but the practicalities of it, you know, just aren't really practical to, you know, shift to other areas. Because the other thing we have to realise is, you know, when they're looking at activities over a year, that weather patterns can be very different every year, and everyone knows that. You know, wind conditions 1 year are completely different from wind conditions another year, and it could be that the economic impact that they were looking at in 1 year is completely different to another year. So looking at economic impacts on that, you know, it has to be over a great number of years, and it has to be evidence-based that it's accurate as well, because just before I conclude on that, Sound of Barra, which the Marine Scotland have said 30,000. Now, we've got landing evidence of in excess of 200,000 from that area. So there's obviously something that's seriously wrong with the gross underestimation of the economic impact.
David.
Convener, I take it we're moving on now to the detail on
basically,
socio-economic and so on, and that's very important. There's a clear divergence of views between the sort of broad brush approach that's been done by Marine Scotland and the impact of, I think, around about 2% on the economy overall, and the evidence we've heard already, and also in the evidence that's been submitted to us. And I would like, again, and forgive me for this, but it's in my constituency, to concentrate on the Small Isles situation and the potential impact in relation to that. But it's not just the fishermen at sea where this is a problem. And I believe there's quite a number of barra boats as well fish in the small isles. So there's an impact over there. And the knock-on effect, there's a critical mass when you're running a harbour like Mallaig, for instance, in relation to provision of ice and boat building and all of these other things, that if the critical mass drops below a certain level, the whole thing then collapses. And if that was to happen in Mallaig, you're not talking about half a dozen jobs here. You're talking about maybe 30 or 40 or more if you take the fishermen and the knock-on effects on shore. And for a community like Mallaig and surrounding area, that's a massive job loss. The equivalent... Yeah, I will do, convener. The equivalent, let's say, in Edinburgh would be 5,000 jobs going. And we know what happens here when a couple of hundred jobs are threatened in a factory. So it's very, very important we get this right. And if the judgments have been made on incorrect information, then it needs to be looked at again. My point about the socio-economic argument is, and the question I would like to ask, if the restricted areas within, let's take the Small Isles MPA, were reduced from what they are at the moment in terms of recommendations, which I think is about 33% of the MPA, if that restricted area was taken down to maybe 20%, would that difference actually allow the boats to fish in the areas they need to fish in?
Well, it would have to be there. If it's not in the right area, it wouldn't do any good. I mean, there's large areas there that they could say you're allowed to fish and it's out in exposed waters and we wouldn't. So it would have to be the right areas this 20% would have to be the right areas.
Presuming that it was in the right areas. And my understanding is that the very detailed work that was done very clearly didn't allow fishing in areas where there were could be problems for the flora and fauna and the mirl and everything else. So if those areas were excluded, I mean, what you're really saying, what I've been told is at the moment that there's a big chunk of excluded areas, including burrowed mud, that don't need to be excluded because they're not achieving anything in terms of conservation. But if those areas were unexcluded, if you like, and the boats could fish there, you'd be getting well over 95% of what you were getting before. So it's a matter of just a bit of detail on the management within there that needs to be dealt with to allow fishermen and the conservation thing to live happily together. Is that right?
Well, for our own fishing sector point of view at the prawns, most of the features are areas that we don't fish on because they're attached to rocks and stones and steep banks and we can't fish there. So if that was the areas that were going to prohibit us from fishing in, then that would, yes, I mean, it would help. It would certainly help. But, I mean, it has to be areas that the boats can fish when the weather's bad. That's protected areas. And I don't think at the meetings there was any of these protected species, apart from burrowed mud, in these areas.
Can I just finish on this point, convener? If the proposed orders were altered then, and you were able to sit down with Marine Scotland and spend a wee bit more time, go back over maybe some of the work that was done to move the restricted area back to enable you to get some of these grounds back into use, would you find that a valuable change in relation to this MPA?
Well, it would be valuable. Of course it would. I mean, anything that we can get back that doesn't endanger the fishermen, where they can work away in better sheltered weather than in sheltered areas, and that has to be good for us. But whether we could come to the right compromise, whether they would agree on the areas
I would have my doubts with the way the process has gone before.
I think we're hopefully moving on, things will be better. So you're really confirming, yes, if you could be involved in the decision on the exact boundaries of the excluded areas with Marine Scotland and SNH, you could probably get to a reasonable position in relation to Small Isles MPA without endangering the conservation aspects.
I would hope that we could do something, because something has to be done, otherwise there's jobs going to go.
We understand that, but we're talking about the way in which they've been proposed, and that there's been a delay in actually putting forward the final versions for consideration by this committee. And we're just trying to dig into a little more of the issues related to that so that we're well aware when these come back, and presumably the Marine Scotland and the ministers will be listening to this conversation just now. And therefore, you know, we would expect that some of these considerations might be taken into account before they do. But I've got several members of the committee, including Claudia and Sarah. But first of all, we've got Alex, who asked a question earlier. Are you finished with your question at the moment on that?
Well, I didn't quite get an answer to it on the safety issue, but if you want me to move on to displacement,
well,
I'll happily do that.
I think probably we had better have Jim, and then yourself, and then Jamie, okay? And then Claudia, and then Sarah.
Okay, thanks very much. Willie McLean really finished where I wanted to start it off, and actually just regarding the areas which it's believed that MPs were not consulted on, it would be interesting to hear from the members how that would affect the number of jobs that he mentioned. Now, I appreciate it may not just be jobs on the trawlers, but there may be onshore jobs, the so-called multiplier effect. So it would be interesting just to hear from everybody whether there'll be a benefit to jobs in short or medium term regarding their own industries or the opposite.
Right, so we'll start off with Alasdair Sinclair on these 2 points.
You're painting an awful bleak picture of what the initiative of MPAs is, and many regard the designations of these MPAs as a very positive step forward with a view to securing inshore fisheries for the future and the communities that so rely on them. Now, one of the things that hasn't been thought about or discussed here today, which I think is very important and must be brought to your attention, is the fact that MPAs might create many opportunities for more jobs. And if we're using a clean and green method like creels, we will benefit the rural communities. Hand diving, etc., will come into its own. The financial benefits that will flow through the communities can only be good, and they'll not be detrimental to the communities. I understand the difficulties that the mobile sector have, the fact that they're going to be displaced. That's something we'll move on to in the socio-economic thing. But the MPAs as a whole must be seen by this group as a very positive step forward with a view to securing the future of many of the rural communities around the coastline of Scotland.
We know your point of view, right. Steve Basterman.
Yeah. As has been previously mentioned, there's a lot of focus on the least impact to the fishing industry. I'd just like to give everyone an idea of the sea angling industry.
I think we've got a fair idea that it's growing.
I'd like to repeat it, if I might, Convener.
Please.
Briefly, there are over 205,000 anglers fish in Scotland every year, sea anglers. About 150,000 of those are Scottish resident anglers. 50,000 come from the UK, and about 5,000 from places like Holland, Spain, rest of Europe. They're contributing around £160 million a year, which is a not insignificant amount. The process has been, I think the process is just a broken model altogether. I don't think dickering around the edges a little bit here, a little bit there will address anything. It really needs to be a cohesive MPA setup. Everybody has data. What should have been involved was a comprehensive, peer-reviewed, independent assessment of all the data that's put forward, whether it's sea angling, days at sea or whatever. Otherwise, it's just who shouts loudest and gets the most attention.
Well, we're here to try and get a moderate and reasoned sort of solution to these things at the moment, and shouting louder will only mean that the sound man has to turn it down. I think we've got to be very careful about making sure that we reflect the different sides of the industry, which is what we're trying to do with this panel at the moment. And I can hear the points of view of the data that's held by the mobile sector, which has already been articulated. If you've got anything to add to that, Kenny McNab, then you might add to it rather than...
I'm afraid I've got to respond to it.
Well,
to what Alasdair Sinclair said, because the committee have got to understand that marine protected areas were to protect features. Yes. They have got absolutely nothing to do with fisheries management. The static sector want to use them, along with Marine Scotland, as a fisheries management tool. That's what they were not designed for. They were designed to protect features in the seabed. The committee have got to understand that.
Well, you know, there's no doubt about it. We understand the points of view that you have and the points of view that the creel men have. The question about whether there's a the protection of stocks is something which we will investigate. You say that, but you know, we need to have a definitive view from Marine Scotland about whether they see that. So thank you for your point of view. Duncan McInnes, briefly.
Just, you know, on the shared marine environment, you know, we have what we consider to be a balanced, you know, fleet that has been sustainable. We've got a creel fleet. I mean, we're the largest association with static gear members in the whole of Scotland. We've been at the leading edge of conservation. One of the things we've been asking Marine Scotland for the last 10 years is to introduce a port limitation scheme. We're seeing light at the end of the tunnel. We're not wanting to see more creels go into the sea, because I was a fisherman myself. I started fishing with 240 ports. I finished 15 years later with 750 ports. If I was still at sea today, I'd be needing 2,000 ports to catch the same amount as I got. So I think we have to have a sensible balance on the way forward on, you know, having a shared and successful and sustainable marine environment for the benefit of all industries. Because we're looking at a marine environment and seeing marine renewables coming in. We're seeing increased fish farming, larger fish farming in. So they're wanting their own section of the seabed. And clearly, you know, with marine planning ahead of us, I think, you know, it's right and proper that we should have discussion on protecting marine features within the overall framework of future marine planning. And as I said previously, no fisherman is wanting to destroy the marine environment. They've shared that marine environment for the last 50, 60 years. Those marine features are there. It's not as if the fishermen have destroyed the marine environment. They've been fishing at it commercially and shared that marine environment for a generation, really. And looking at fragile communities, you know, like the West Coast communities from the Clyde all the way up to Balharry, we're now faced with a dilemma on how we take forward the management. No one's against marine protected areas. It's the management of marine protected areas that needs to be sorted out. At the moment, there seems to be a clear difference of opinion on the way that that management should be concluded. I think there is a way forward on it, and it does need more discussion with stakeholders. It needs more discussion, and if I look that our own MSP, Angus McNeill, has seen the seriousness of this and has written to the Islands Minister to make sure that we don't move quickly into making a final decision on marine protected areas without having the full picture of the way to go forward. So I would stress caution to the committee that there is a way forward, but it has to be done with full consultation before we take that step.
understand your position. I wonder if you could comment on the necessity to bring in an emergency order for the Wester Ross MPA when it was alleged that dredging was taking place in the voluntary exclusion zones of the Wester Ross MPA by the Shearach 3 SY85 on the 31st of July and the 1st of August, and how that squares with your assertion that you are interested in maintaining the marine infrastructure.
I am quite free to discuss, you know, the incident that was involved on that day in question. The skipper made a full statement to the fishery office in Ullapool that there was a total misunderstanding in the different zoning that was in that area. There was a zoning approach that scallop dredging kept deeper than 20 metres, yet there was one zone that had a total prohibition in it. There were seven different zones. Now, Marine Scotland didn't have the courtesy to send details of those voluntary measures to the scallop vessels that had scallop entitlements, which, in my opinion, they should have done. That vessel was unaware. He had a fishery cruiser beside him that Saturday morning. The fishery protection vessel didn't tell him that he was operating in a voluntary closed area. The vessel, the area in question, had a, where he was fishing, he didn't go shallower than a depth of 30 metres that morning. So he was well within the agreed 20-metre zoning. He has requested information of Marine Scotland to show evidence that he caused any damage in that area, and that photographic evidence hasn't been returned to him. So it was a total misunderstanding, and that has been was sent to Marine Scotland. And I mean, if everyone in life, you know, doesn't misunderstand something, you know, I think everyone here, it would be empty, you know, if you look at a misunderstanding or an interpretation of what is available.
One case of the MPA being impinged upon in some way. There are Northern Ireland boats that have been implicated and others in the same place. And, you know, evidence of that has mounted up. So whatever happened, the question fundamentally was about looking after the marine environment and there being breaches of that by mobile gear boats. And indeed, in the purposes of this inquiry just now, I just wanted to make that clear that it's not all black and white, but I thank you for your explanation about that. Alasdair Hughson has a point of view on this as well.
I'm afraid I must take issue with the evidence submitted by Duncan McInnes. I was made aware of the incursion into the voluntary zone by the Shearach 3 within probably 15 or 20 minutes of it happening. There was phone calls from local residents who had been out taking photographs of the vessel. Within half an hour or an hour, I had these photographs by email. And it was decided between myself and some of the local residents that if it was to be proven that this infraction had taken place, then we must get evidence on the seabed, because we were aware the vessel may well have been just towing his dredges below the boat. They may not have been on the seabed. So it was decided and it was arranged that a local vessel would take me out to the area and I would dive on it, which occurred on the Tuesday, I believe. I dived in the area. I found the dredge marks on the seabed. The shallowest point of the dredge marks was 19 metres. And I have video evidence of that, which has been submitted to Marine Scotland.
I wanted to clarify that these things happen, and that that did happen, and that there may be different interpretations of what happened. But the fact is that mobile gear fishermen, dredger in this case, created a situation where the MPA was brought forward earlier than it might have been, and that was because of their behaviour. So we have to deal with situations where these things happen, and we want to try and make sure that we get to a situation where everyone actually understands what their duties are and that they actually apply them as well as they can. First of all, Claudia Beamish, and then Sarah Boyack, and then Jamie McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. Could I focus Briefly on the Scottish Fishermen's Federation socio-economic analysis, which is the scoping effects, which focus particularly on Kintyre in the first case study. But to broaden it out, both that and the other case study presented by the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, they don't, in my view, having read them with great care, focus on the future generations. And there's very clear argument about depopulation of very fragile coastal communities, which is the reason, of course, that we're very keen to hear your evidence today. And I would like comment from any panel members who would like to say anything about the relationship between sustainable fish yields and the development of areas for juvenile fish, for instance, or any other issues that bear relevance to this. And I would also stress in relation to your comment, Kenny, earlier about the management, that in my view, my understanding of the MPAs and the orders is that the reason for any fishing management is, in this case, for the MPAs, actually to protect and enhance for future generations, which is in all our interests, the protected features and the protected habitats. So I think it's very important that we bring this into the equation of the socioeconomic issue, because we know of places across the globe, and I have evidence of it here in Living Blue Planet report by WWF International, of places across the globe where there are fragile communities which can no longer fish. Now, I don't want to be too dramatic about this, but it's partly about protecting the sustainable seas per se, but it is also about future generations in fragile communities, and I would value some comment on that.
Thank you. Right. Kenny McNab.
I'd like to thank Claudia. I live in Tarbert, in Kintyre, and there's three fishing communities in Kintyre: Camelton, Carradale and Tarbert. Tarbert probably the most dependent in fishing. I'm pretty passionate about it. We've got about 50 full-time fishermen in Tarbert. Even if three scallop boats are affected, two from Carradale and one which watched from the island of Lyng, but all our scallops are processed in a factory in Tarbert, and two factories in Tarbert actually. These guys, because of the South End Arran MPA and the closures in the Sound of Jura, are considering packing it in. If the factory in Tarbert closes, or the two factories in Tarbert, small factories, you're talking about between 12 and 15 jobs. With the fishermen included, it could be over 30 jobs. And we have the same scenario as Dave mentioned here in Mallaig earlier. That equates to 2.5% of the employment in Tarbert. That then equates with 17,500 jobs in Glasgow. If that happened, quite sure the Scottish Government would react to it fairly quickly. But we see the community of Tarbert being decimated because all of these jobs are held by people with young families. People will not wait in rural communities unless they have a full-time job. Part-time jobs, they will leave and go to the Central Belt. What will happen in Tarbert? The school role at the moment is just borderline for closure. If half a dozen of these families leave with young children, the school will close, or Gyland Butte Council will close it. If that happens, the community dies. It becomes a retirement home for old people. We don't want to see that. At the moment, the community is sustainable. Now, many people have said, from the south end of Arran, have said that loads of jobs will be created. In fact, I think Coast stated that 2,700 jobs can be created by ecotourism, which you're probably hinting at. Ecotourism has been tried over the years in our area. And
I wasn't hinting at anything. I was simply saying about specifically about fishermen being able and fisherwomen, if there are, being able to fish in future generations in your fragile communities.
Yes, well,
that was a point I was making.
Well, we know it's sustainable at the moment, and we want to keep it that way. It's at a level where it is sustainable. I mean, the fleet over the last number of years, there's only about a third of the boats that there were in the 1980s and 90s. The fleet has completely dropped. But the point I want to make about ecotourism jobs is, on the west coast of Scotland, look at the weather we get. Ecotourism jobs take up 3 or 4 months of the year. That's part-time jobs. Young families will not wait in the area for part-time work. They will move to the central belt. So part-time ecotourism jobs is not going to take the place of full-time work.
I have a view on Claudia Beamish's question in the panel. David Fraser, Ali Hughson.
Sustainability. The last 6 days before I came here, I fished in an area, discovered a scallop bed that I found in 1990. I caught 4,760 kilograms of scallops, working just daylight hours. That's 5 tons in old money. Some of these scallops have been eaten in our super restaurants in Oban already. The rest have gone to London and Europe. How's that not sustainable? This is somewhere that I discovered in 1990. That's 28 years ago. That is sustainability.
It is very important, of course, and that's why we're here today, to consider the sustainability of jobs, of fragile communities, the risks of depopulation. What I'm saying to you is that if the MPAs are protecting the future of these areas, then it is very possible that changes might jeopardise the future for the next generation. And I'm asking you what consideration there has been taken of that, because in the Scottish Fishermen's Federation economic analysis, I don't see that. That's what I'm asking. And I respect the fact that
the economic figures which have been given were not accurate.
Scottish Fishermen's Federation, that I don't see that analysis there, but that's just my
view.
Well,
I can't speak for the Federation, but...
Clearly, the economic impact assessment of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation did to make clear reference that it was a short summary that they had done. It was a short space of time that they had to develop. Six weeks, they had to develop what was clearly a huge task. And that's just the start of our process. But looking at fragile communities, if you look at Barra, for example, the factory in Barra employs 40 full-time people, not part-time. In the summer, it's higher. It provides summer employment for students. There's 8 trawlers from Barra fishing off Mallaig there, all young skippers with young families. If they're going to leave, that'll decimate Barra. Look at Uist. 30 jobs there in scallop processing, supplying 50% of the raw material there. Stornoway, I look at Stornoway where I live myself, Macduff Shellfish that have the prawn processing plant there. That plant has been there since 1960, definitely sustainable. And I've seen Stornoway with industries coming and going. Harris Tweed went, came back. Ornish Fabrication Yard has come and gone several times, and yet the prawn processing factory has stayed there for the best part of 60 years. It is sustainable at current levels of effort, and the marine features that we're talking about and discussing are there despite, alongside and in harmony with what has been going on. So why take away the the traditional industry that has been working in harmony. Let's work together and get the balance that will marry the two together for the future benefit of everyone, the marine environment and the communities.
There are questions about the potential for the stock, you know, existing well into the future at that level. And, you know, that's something which we can't bottom out at this particular meeting. But Claudia Beamish's question is, I've heard the answers around the table here. Steve Basterman's next, and then we've got to move on very quickly.
Yeah, the sustainability of a single stock, whether it's scallops, mackerel or whatever, that doesn't indicate a healthy and diverse marine environment. That indicates a monoculture. And that's one of the biggest threats you've got to developing tourism for sea angling. And sea angling tourism onto the West Coast is not just a 3 or 4 month activity. It's a round of the year activity because there are different species at different times of the year that are fished for. It makes a substantial amount of money into local communities. It could make more. But for it to make more, the environment must be diverse. Sea anglers can't catch scallops.
Ali Hughson hasn't had a say on this. I think we've heard kind of both sides on this particular point, but Ali Hughson just now.
I'd like to make the point from the point of view of the members of the Scottish Scallop Divers Association that marine protected areas, you know, whether we strike a balance or not, marine protected areas, well, in our experience, undoubtedly increase economic activity in our sector. I'd just like to make that clear.
Okay, thank you for making that clear. We have to get Sarah Boyack, then Jamie McGregor, and then Mike Russell. Well, we've been dealing with the members of the committee, and you will certainly get your chance to ask questions like everyone else. Okay, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I want to ask for comments on one of the pieces of evidence we've had submitted, which is around the South Arran MPA, and it really follows on that last discussion about different types of fishing and what evidence we have. And this committee has certainly discussed the issue around South Arran for the best part of a decade on and off now, and we do have quite a lot of evidence. And I just wondered for people's views on the impact on inshore fisheries of the MPA in South Arran, because we've had quite positive evidence submitted to the committee, and I just wanted to test that out amongst the various members and the panel in front of us.
Okay, the smaller fishing, presumably. Could you just clarify for me, Kenny McNab, just before you do, how many of the boats out of Tarbert and Carradale and are above the 150-ton mark?
Was that to me or is that...
No, to Kenny. Kenny McNab, sorry.
I don't think we've got any.
Right, OK.
The 150-ton for the prawn trawler in the Clyde. I think it was 120-ton.
Is it?
For the Clyde.
OK. Just so...
There might be one over 120-ton.
Somewhere in that area, yes. To answer Sarah Boyack's points then, please. Yeah.
Yes. Regarding the South Arran MPA, when we discussed with Marine Scotland, we really went into great detail to try and protect the mellal beds which were identified around the south end of Arran. And we had given up the scallop guys who were present at the meetings, gave up a rather large chunk of where they earn their living in the consultation. As it turned out, it's now stopped scallop dredging's banned altogether. All the scallop grounds in the south end of Arran have been, well, in the proposal, there'll be no scallop dredging. This, you know, it's a big issue for particularly two of our members, two boats in membership for the CFA, who are based in Carradale. And their biggest issue is that it's the weather factor, the safety one, because they use that area for protection at all times. I mean, you've only got to look at Arran, it's stuck right in the middle of the Clyde. and it gives you protection. Doesn't matter what way the wind is, you get protected somewhere. And the skipper has commented to me on a number of occasions, in fact, I think he's in the observers group here, that it's quite frightening at times if he's fishing in the Ayrshire coast and he's got to go towards the south end of Arran to get protection from northwest wind or westerly wind to get there, and he's not allowed to fish when he gets there. It's in the winter, it's a short day. You've only got maybe 8-9 hours of daylight. By the time he gets across there, half the day's away, what does he do? In that area, he, in the winter time, he's maybe not making a fortune, but he's keeping the wheels turning, and the boys are getting a wage every week until the weather gets better and he can go and fish somewhere else. That opportunity's been taken away from him, both him and his son. His young son skippers the other boat, and they're going to be, he's looking at a loss of maybe between 30 and 40% in his gross for the year.
Okay. Sarah, did you want to come back?
Yeah, well, the question was about the impact we've had from the no-take zone in Lamlash Bay and the fact there's quite a lot of research from coast over the last few years. And given what's being proposed for South Arran, I was trying to test out the issue of inshore fisheries in terms of protected features, whether it has made a difference, and what people think about the process of consultation on the South Arran proposals, whether people are happy with them or not.
Do you want to come back again?
No, we're certainly not happy with them, no, because it now includes a large area. When the Minister announced his proposals, there's a large area of burrowed mud that wasn't in the first consultation. That the prawn boats are now affected, who weren't affected in the first place. But as far as the no-take zone is concerned, I was involved right from the very beginning in dealing with the no-take zone. And we can only... The coast are telling us that there's improvements in the no-take zone. And I'm not surprised at that. I'm not surprised at it at all, not in the least. But they say it will move to outside the no-take zone. But we're not seeing any vast difference outside the no-take zone. And I believe the Albanamara in Marine Scotland Science are there this week doing trials. And we'll be quite happy to hear, you know, we'll be quite interested to hear what the science is on that, you know, when they've actually done it, because then that will be science that we can listen to. It will be independent science done by Marine Scotland, because other people produce science sometimes and it's maybe biased.
Okay, we're hearing you. Duncan McInnes is on this point. Yeah,
just, you know, following on from what you... Sarah Boyer makes reference to a no-take zone. Our experience, as I said earlier on, is Broad Bay in Lewis, and it would be useful for the committee to have some research done in Broad Bay in Lewis that I would say is a no-take zone since 1984. The evidence is when Marine Scotland Science did go in and investigated what happened in the area, you know, it was a prolific scallop area. Everyone would have said, oh, that'll be full of scallop divers by now. It'll be full of fish by now. And it's clear that that didn't happen. So I think the committee should take on board evidence that Marine Scotland has of what an area that was, I would say, did become a no-take zone, because there's no mobile gear activity in it for over 30 years now. And if we're wanting the marine environment just to be, you know, only starfish and nothing else, I'm pretty sure that Lamlash Bay or one of those or whichever base, you know, you'll start seeing starfish appearing after a few years, but then starfish will become the main predator and there'll be very, very little left. And I'll leave for members of the committee, it's not my report, it's Marine Scotland report of what's in Broad Bay after 30 years of a no-take zone. So I think it would be useful before we create other no-take zones to have a look at what we have created with a previous administration 30 years ago.
I think we're talking about very different terrains here, actually.
I've seen photographic evidence.
Yeah, I know.
It's not just starfish. Really, for the record, we do need to have that clarified.
With all due respect, after how many years?
Okay, that is something which we cannot discuss here. We're discussing the MPAs as they are. We're going to come back to Jamie McGregor as an addition to the committee for today.
Just on that point about starfish, I've seen the damage that starfish can do to mussel farms. But we've listened to a lot of points made by different people, and I very much respect all of the different sectors of the fisheries that are here today. And I'd like to see seas where, you know, everyone can catch, the sea anglers can catch fish, and the prawn trawlers can still go on, the dredgers can still go on, and, you know, with sustainability. But I'm an MSP for Highlands and Islands, and I have had more concerns expressed to me over this particular consultation than I think anything else that I've ever had to do with fisheries. And it appears that fishermen were led to believe throughout the consultation period that measures would be proportionate and would stick to the protection of specific marine features. Now, Kenny McNab made the point that MPAs are there to protect features and are not a management tool for fisheries. And I think that's got to be convener. You've got to look into that, because there's nobody here from Marine Scotland who could answer that point today.
Have you a question?
Yes, I do, yes. The other thing is that the broad brush economic figures seem to fail to capture in detail the significant economic impact on different fishing vessels. It appears that people will lose their livelihoods. My concern is jobs. And in reference to the scallop fishing particularly, somebody made the point that you can't, divers, produce scallops, but only I think about 1% of all the scallops that are eaten in Scottish restaurants are actually caught by divers. So how are we going to keep this scallop industry going? You can't catch them in creels either. If you don't have scallop dredging, how are we going to keep this significant industry going for Scotland?
Right. Alasdair Sinclair and Ali Hughson.
I'm sorry to bring this to the table, but I think Jamie should have declared an interest in the sense that he has an attachment to the Clyde Fishermen's Association and speaks often on their behalf.
Convener, I am an honorary vice president of the Clyde Fishermen's Association.
Right, okay. But you've asked a question, so have we any answers to that? Thank you for that clarification.
Thank you, Chair.
Ali Hughson, did you have a point there?
Nobody's suggesting stopping scallop dredging in Scottish waters. We would contend that proportionate MPAs allowed to recover would contribute to the scallop dredging. As well as, as well as to the diving.
Okay, Kenny McNab.
I'd just ask a question of Alasdair. If MPAs go ahead in the form that they're being proposed, I would imagine diving for scallops will increase. I know for a fact that there are times of the year, Alasdair, when you find it difficult to sail dive scallops and you've got to store them. Would you see a reduction in the price of your scallops if the diving fishery increased and your market would struggle?
It's certainly possible that there would be an increase in the number of vessels and the number of scallop divers and therefore a knock-on increase in the amount of scallops on the market. Simple economics dictates that if there's more on the market and the demand hasn't increased, then the price would have to drop. I think that's without question. It's not something that we would like to see, but it would be inevitable. But I would like to say that in our experience, the increase in the number of scallops available for scallop divers to put on the market would be very marked. It would be, a large increase. We're not talking small increases here over the medium to long term.
Well, I think we could be very careful about cross-examining each other here. We are asking the questions. But I will make a comment that obviously people who catch lobsters save them up in tanks for the Christmas market. So there are various different kinds of ways in which that, and the bottom fell out of the Christmas market in Europe when we had the bank crashes. You know, so these things crop up. There are changes in these sort of things. So without any further cross-examination at the moment, Jamie, had you another point?
Yes, I was trying to get to this bit about the scallop. What would keep all these new restaurants that we've got in Scotland on the West Coast, all of whom serve scallops, who would they get their scallops from if the dredging industry?
Is that Alasdair Sinclair?
Can I just say that having recently engaged with four Michelin star chefs south of the border, we have decided upon embarking upon an initiative where we'll be able to sell as many hand-dived scallops as we can possibly get, with a view to selling not only south of the border, but also selling into Europe. There is an appetite, because of the good story that hand-diving is, and the good story that creel fishing is. And I think Kenny's question, whilst it has some merit, hasn't been properly thought out, because we have discussed huge levels of hand-dived scallops going abroad, and this initiative has only happened in the past week.
Yes, but the point I was making is that only 1% of the scallops that are now landed in Scotland come from hand-diving. There's 99% of the ones come from other methods.
We are hoping to increase that 1% to maybe 5 or 6%. Which is huge in volume.
But it's still going to leave a huge hole if you don't have any dredge. That's the only point I'm making.
Well, there's two other people I'm going to bring in here in Mike Russell. So, Willie John McLean and then Steve Basterman.
Entirely about scallops, but we would have the same problem with prawns, because I sell to a prawn factory. They're 40 miles down the road. They employ 80 people, and 50% of their product comes from our area. So they would struggle if they didn't get their raw produce.
Indeed. And Steve Basterman.
I repeat the point that MPAs aren't just there to meet the financial needs of the fishing industry. There are a lot of other people, recreational and tourist industries, which have an interest in the marine environment.
Okay. Mike Russell.
Point. I mean, there has been some criticism of this committee for holding a session in which it heard from this group of witnesses rather than a wider group of witnesses. And, of course, the reason for doing so is because I think it's fair to say that this session is not about MPAs per se, and everybody has accepted and most welcomed the MPA process. It is about the issue of boundaries and management and how they're implemented. And I think if you were interested in that, you'd come to the end of the session pretty depressed, because I'm somebody that likes compromise and the ability of people to work together, and there hasn't been much sign of it. I just want to ask a very simple question, because it would seem to me from what I hear that the opinion, that the weight of opinion coming from the public is very much in favour of conservation of the areas in question. And that means that further compromise is going to be needed if there is to be any consensus at all. What is that compromise? For each of you, and a brief answer, I suspect the chairman will insist, the convener will insist on a brief answer, probably he should. What is the outcome you want to see? How realistic is that, and what can you do to achieve it? Because I think at the present moment, it looks as if the divisions are still pretty great, and that will continue to create difficulties for everybody involved in this.
Here we go, around Robin. Alasdair Sinclair first.
Much of what Mike has to say, but I think the way ahead has got to be spatial management. We have to separate the mobile guys from the static guys, and you win on more than one occasion here, because you create that healthy creel industry supporting community, and you also create within those spatially managed areas where the science, universities, etc., etc., can have their young students come out, do research work with a view to securing
better ideas for the future and getting away from best guess science.
Okay. Duncan McInnes.
Certainly on the way forward is a zoning approach which has buffer zones around those marine features. It can and easily done by depth. Seasonality, you know, we operate in the Western Isles, seasonal closures that have been very successful for the last 30 years. Seasonal closures limit activity, you know, over, and the words that we were needing to look at was remove and prohibit, which we do by a depth zoning. Those features, Merle, for example, is all under 30 metres, SNH have confirmed that. So zoning depth to protect those features, looking at set nets in all those marine protected areas. Marine Scotland have come with a clear policy, a total prohibition on set nets. There should be a seasonal approach to when set nets are there and a depth level where they couldn't be set to reduce the entanglement possibility at shallower depths. And I think, you know, a zoning approach by depth, seasonal variations will reduce, prohibit, and remove and limit. We've already spoken about limitation on horse tonnage of vessels, which will reduce the impact of large vessels in those sites. Certainly within the Barra SAC, they're talking about a weekend ban, you know, in that area, which further reduces effort in that area. Have a nighttime curfew as an innovative way of reducing effort in an area. So there are ways of managing those fisheries for the benefit and reducing effort, and it would be a win-win for everyone, I would say.
Can I just say before I start, I'm very disappointed in Alasdair, because he's actually brought this to the table where it looks like a static gear and trawl conflict, and it's not. There's very little research done into creels. There's been no surveys done, no research. They're one of the most unregulated fisheries, or they are one of the most unregulated fisheries in Scotland. So I'm disappointed with that. But I mean,
but just a minute. You know, this committee has dealt with the Loch Torridon situation, and we're well aware of the questions that arise there, and you know, zonal management and so on, and indeed, effort have all got to be fixed in order for that to work. So we're aware of that, but yes, we've got to be careful about accusing individuals across the table of a particular point of view. We're here to decide, and I thank you for that, but we understand the situation a little more.
Yes, I must apologise about that, but it does seem unfair. But I would like us to carry on with the process that we started with Marine Scotland, SNH, if there was more transparency. Yeah. If we could see videos, and then just what Dave said, we could surely agree, because there is, I mean, there's room for everyone to survive. And these areas that they're pointing out, these special features, the fishing doesn't impact on them. So if they were to put large buffer zone rounds them, around the areas they want to protect, and leave gateways. So the boats up in Wester Ross and in our own areas could go from one town to the other, so they didn't have to haul their nets, and safety wasn't going to be an issue. Then, I mean, surely we could sit down and discuss these things and get them sorted out. I mean, dialogue. I mean, because it is something that everyone... I mean, regardless of everyone with their own opinions, it is something that everyone here wants. Yes. And it's just a way of joining it all together.
Steve Basterman, Kenny McNab, and then Dave Thompson for a final point. Right?
Just to go back to your original point, Michael, and I agree we should go back and revisit it, but it shouldn't be revisited in a bits and pieces, one set here, one set there. Have a full independent assessment. Get the data, get people to bring the data, get it peer-reviewed, get it assessed, the impact, socio-economic and industry impacts, and make decisions based on fact and not fiction.
Okay. Kenny McNab.
I never thought I would agree with somebody from the Anglin. But I think that it's... We have got to get to a stage where a proper socio-economic study is done, not just for the sake of the communities who are involved. This is something that should have been done in the beginning, and it wasn't done. It's the part of the whole jigsaw that was lacking, and that's why there's been so much uproar about it. And the proposal should, as far as we see it, the proposal should be amended and we go back to consultation.
Close to the point that obviously it's, if they were amended, then they have to go out to consultation. So, you know, that's going to prolong the process of any adoption of MPAs, because if there are changes from what's been proposed at the moment, then there will be that opportunity to discuss this all in great detail again. Dave, if you can focus on one point that we haven't already dealt with.
Yeah, thank you,
really
convener.
Has to draw this to conclusion.
Yeah, absolutely. It was really just to make the point that I've had a number of representations made to me from creel fishermen who are actually worried about some of the proposals because of displacement of the prawn trawlers into areas where they're currently laying their creels. So, you know, the current proposals, the point I'm making is that there are many creel fishermen who don't agree with them, and if the trawlers are pushed out, you create all sorts of conflict and other unintended consequences. So it was just to sort of put a wee bit of balance in, I think. More a comment than a question, unless Alasdair wants to come back on it.
Yes, Mr. Sinclair.
I've heard from many creel fishermen that they've been told by mobile operators that they're going to be hemmed into the MPAs, which is not a good situation. We do hope that we can manage the MPAs in such a way that it doesn't create the honeypot effect that Torridon created at the outset of that initiative. However, gear conflict, as we all know, is a problem. It exists from the Solway to the Tweed. It extends out to 20 miles offshore, blah, blah, blah. I hear where you're coming from. But there are many forward-thinking creel fishermen out there that think that displacement should not be an issue. And if there was more goodwill out at sea, which I wish there was personally myself, there wouldn't be gear conflict, and we could become the brothers in arms that some have previously alluded to as maybe becoming.
I think we're going to stop at that point. You have all had a fair round of opportunity to comment. I'd like to thank you for that. We hope that this exploration of the issues around MPAs will lead the Marine Scotland and the government to hear what's been said by these very detailed views, with the offer to provide more facts and figures if required. And we believe that they'll be listening to this, because the government agreed to for us to have this session to hear these views, so that the views can be taken on board. So I'd like to thank the witnesses very much. It's been a big help to us, and we, of course, will be discussing these matters in private. We're going to have a short suspension so that everyone can leave the room fairly quickly. We have other business in public to deal with, and also private business after that. So thank you very much, everybody, and I suspend for a minute or two. agenda item 4, which is subordinate legislation. The fourth items for the committee to consider the negative instrument as listed on the agenda, i.e. Reservoirs Scotland Amendment Regulation 2015, SSI 2015/315. I refer members to the paper. And are there any comments about this? There are no comments, as far as I can see. So I ask the committee, are you agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? We are agreed, are we? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We're agreed. We will make no comments about this. Future meeting details. The next meeting of the committee on the 30th September will be considering Parts 8 and 6 of the Land Reform Scotland Bill on deer management and sporting rates. And as agreed earlier, we will now move into private session. Thank you.